In half an hour, there's a chance to tune in to some extraordinary sounds when Peter France reveals a hidden world where sounds are slowed down and made audible to the human ear. For example, when the sound that bats make is slowed down, we can discover how they use sound to navigate and hunt, and a world of complex patterns is revealed. That's High Speed Radio at 8:30. Now, Melvyn Bragg presents a special edition of The Roots of English, devoted to the language of Britain's great wartime leader, in Churchill's roar.
We shall not fail or falter, we shall not weaken or tire. Neither the sudden shock of battle nor the long-drawn trials of vigilance and exertion will wear us down. Give us the tools and we will finish the job.
He really took to English like a duck to water.
The phrase he uses is, Hitler is now sprawling all over Europe. What a fabulously clever word to use in those circumstances.
There was a way in which Churchill was a pioneer of the soundbite.
And he is the kind of Mozart of speech.
I have to tell you now, that no such undertaking.
Over the skyline, to the south, lit up with a ruddy glow.
Here is the midnight news, and this is Alvar Liddell reading.
Up to 10 orders, our field guns, our medium guns, all the guns in the fleet.
Can I do you now, sir?
Deep under the streets of Westminster, just behind 10 Downing Street, I'm sitting at a broad desk in a small and strangely intimate room. To one side, a green-shaded lamp, might it belong to Sam Spade, and a heavy black telephone with, oddly, a bright green handset. Comfortable armchairs sit cosily next to the desk, just a few feet away from the unexpected feature that occupies the other side of the room, a bed. Because this is primarily a bedroom, Sir Winston Churchill's bedroom, and his workplace in the Cabinet War Rooms. And I'm sitting at his desk in the place that was his HQ 60 years ago, while sirens wailed warnings across London and valiant men and women were giving their lives half a continent away to liberate Europe. A map of Europe hangs directly behind the pillow where Churchill laid his head. France is mostly hidden behind the curvy bedhead, but Britain stands proudly, clearly alone. Churchill reportedly once said that during the war the people of Britain had the lion's heart. I, he said, had the luck to give the roar.
All the world that is still free marvels at the composure and fortitude with which the citizens of London...
Churchill was all his life a powerful orator, yet he had to wait until he was 65, in 1940, when he was called on to lead the country under arms for his oratorical finest hour.
It is a message of good cheer to our fighting forces on the seas.
He spoke directly to people, and whatever they may have thought of him before the conflict, now they listened and almost to a man and woman were moved, enthused, and mightily strengthened by his words, many of them dreamed up and rehearsed in this very room. In this program, I'm going to try to get to the heart of that linguistic power, to find out just what it was about the phraseology, the imagery, and the way he actually uttered the words that gave Churchill what we'd call today charisma, the power to reach out to people, the majesty of rhetoric, and the common touch. Yet common, Churchill was not. He was a toff.
His vowels and consonants are typical of someone of his background at that time. It's old-fashioned when we look at it today. We hear, for example, the quality of the vowel, the a vowel, in things like that man. He doesn't quite say that man, but more like that man.
Professor John Wells, a phonetician from University College London, has closely analysed the Churchillian accent.
Which then was unremarkable, but now strikes us, as you would expect to hear from, I think he was an old Harrovian, an ex-public schoolboy. And for that period, it was, I think, fairly typical of received pronunciation. And the absence of glottal stops, where nowadays everybody, almost everybody, uses them in a word like statement for the T before the M sound there. Churchill doesn't. But there's a phrase I heard him saying, referring to somebody's veracity of statement.
The Führer's reputation for veracity of statement might be seriously impugned.
There you have veracity of statement, where, in a modern pronunciation, you'd expect veracity of statement.
Winston Churchill was very grand. Born in 1874, among the splendours of one of England's noblest great houses, Blenheim Palace, in Oxfordshire, he grew up at the height of Victorian magnificence. And though the family was no longer in its full pomp, and Blenheim was never actually Winston's home, he was nevertheless a Marlborough, descendant of Queen Anne's great army commander, John Churchill, Duke of Marlborough. Churchill's roots were fiercely and proudly English. And when he came to buy his own piece of English turf, it was, unsurprisingly, a piece of history as well as a piece of property. It said that Churchill's nanny delighted the boy with her stories of the Garden of England, and it was an old Kentish manor house, Chartwell, that the grown man fell in love with.
We can open the curtains and the blind here.
And above all, with its views of an England unchanged and unchanging.
It's a stunning view.
My guide to Chartwell is the National Trust's property manager there, Carol Kenwright.
Oh, wonderful.
And that is the reason he bought Chartwell.
And you can see, even on a day which is a rather heavily overcast, dead midwinter day, it's still terrific. And the idea of the Weald is out there, isn't it? There's
absolutely
no question of that.
It is the Weald of
England. A real big reach and very broad. I can see why he could summon up England from all that. And, of course, the great traditional enemy is just across the sea.
We stood all alone a year ago, and to many countries it seemed that our account was closed. We were finished. All this tradition of ours, our school history, our songs, this part of the history of our country, all were gone and finished and liquidated. Very different is the mood today.
Almost 50 years after he'd left school to take up a commission in the army, Winston Churchill was invited back to his old school, Harrow, to address them on October the 29th, 1941.
There was no flinching, no thought of giving
in. It was stirring stuff he gave his fellow Harrovians that wartime Wednesday afternoon. He reflected on the need for imagination and also upon its perils, the danger of imagining the worst when in war things may often turn out for the better.
That we have only to persevere to conquer.
Churchill was fired by the England of his imagination, and though when he went up to Harrow in 1888 he proved himself far from gifted at the classics and maths, his enthusiasm for the English language was quick to surface. Paul Addison has just written a new book on Churchill, the Unexpected Hero, and he joined me and Carol Kenwright at Chartwell to talk about these early years.
He really took to English like a duck to water. He won a competition for reciting 1,200 lines, Macaulay's Lays of Ancient Rome, because he simply enjoyed the language so much. He enjoyed the rhythm, the vocabulary so much.
He won a prize for writing a poem when he was 15 at the school, didn't he?
Yes, it's an extraordinary poem. It's about an influenza epidemic and how it crosses the world, starting in Asia, and gets to Europe and ravages Germany and France. It's a very Churchillian poem in some ways, though no one would claim any great poetic merits for it. But one of the curious things is the influenza epidemic proves to be powerless to cross the English Channel. But I'll just give you a little bit of flavour from it. Father Neptune strove right well to moderate this plague of hell and thwart it in its course. And though it passed the streak of brine and penetrated this thin line, it came with broken force. For though it ravaged far and wide both village, town, and countryside, its power to kill was o'er, and with the favouring winds of spring, blessed is the time of which I sing, it left our native shore.
Patriotism in the face of influenza.
Nothing moves an Englishman so much as the threat of invasion, the reality unknown for 1,000 years.
Can you tell us about the room in which we find ourselves now? What's the room we're in now?
This is a study. It's the oldest part of the house. It has the large south-facing window, so it takes in the magnificent view. And he placed his desk alongside the window at right angles so he could always see it. And this is where he worked from.
We're talking about a room something like 30, 35 feet long and 20-ish feet wide.
Correct.
A high ceiling, which is like the ceiling of a barn. Wood, 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 right up there. And this is a very long desk. It's about 3 or 4 times longer than
maybe four times longer than the average desk, and it's at standing height, so we assume that he stood as he worked at this.
Churchill always worked in here standing up. He seldom sat at his desk other than to sign something. And he used reference books and papers, and he'd have the books stacked on the shelves and open here at the pages he wanted, and he would pace up and down this wooden floor dictating. So he dictated as he thought and as he referred to his books.
Last time I spoke to you, I quoted the lines of Longfellow which President Roosevelt had written out for me in his own hand. I have some other lines which are well known, but which seem apt and appropriate to our fortunes tonight, and I believe they will be so judged wherever the English language is spoken or the flag of freedom flies. For while the tired waves, vainly breaking, seem here no painful inch to gain, far back through creeks and inlets making, comes silent flooding in the main. And not by eastern windows only, when daylight comes in the light. In front the sun climbs slow, how slowly, but westward, look! The land is bright.
He conjures up very vivid images of what it is to be British and what it is to live in Britain. This is to a tremendously urbanised society. They're all living in cities. They're all having bombs falling on them. But he kind of conjures up something grand and romantic about Britishness.
Gene Seaton is Professor of Media History at the University of Westminster.
The country and the rural and the sea. Sea was more important then. I often think now that we have no notion of the sea, but for them the sea was absolutely key. It was protecting them. And so he conjures up that sense of a place with edges and with a centre.
After this battle in France abates its force, there will come the battle for our islands, for all that Britain is and all that Britain means.
An island race. And a mongrel history, you know, a mongrel history. We call on the strengths of the weakest members of our society. Brilliant. But, you know, mongrel race. We're not single, we're not solitary, we don't have pure blood, we have impure blood. And that's our strength.
And this retrospective aspect was central to the language Churchill used to evoke Britain, a point that particularly struck the writer and broadcaster Peggy Reynolds.
And interestingly, in the transcripts, the island is always capitalised. So it's this concept of something small, very contained, separate from the rest of the world, that he's trying to convey to his audience all the time. This sense that they are separate, they are different, this is an island race. Next thing that he uses a lot is imagery to do with heroes and knights of old and crusaders and chivalric messages. And this, of course, is particularly associated with his idea of the young men going off to fight in the war.
Churchill responded poorly to the formal academic training offered by Harrow, and he struggled to get into Sandhurst. He only succeeded at the third attempt. But as soon as he was dispatched to India with his regiment, he got down to serious study. Sitting in the working room at Chartwell, known as the factory, Paul Addison told me about the almost industrial routine of enforced reading the young cavalry officer undertook during the long afternoons of inactivity, in order to equip himself with the necessary tools for the career he planned to have in Parliament.
He'd acquired this almost musical love of English at Harrow, love of verse, love of patriotic verse, love of narrative, and superimposed on that now, he conducted a great program of self-education, reading an enormous range of authorities, Gibbon, Macaulay, Darwin on the Origin of the Species, Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations. Really very serious reading. He wanted to equip himself with a philosophy.
Can you tell us something about the essay, The Scaffolding of Rhetoric?
Well, it appears to have been written when he was in India. He would be about 23 or 24. And it was based on his reading of the great English speeches by Cromwell, Chatham, Gladstone, Disraeli. And what he did was remarkable. He analysed these speeches to discover what their techniques were. And, for example, he said that most of them used very short syllables. They used rather homely language a great deal of the time. He also said that while the speech had a great accumulation of argument in it, and that was one of the techniques of a good orator, it often ended with a statement which was very extreme and which gave the audience emotional catharsis. So, for example, when you think of his speeches in 1940, we will fight them on the beaches, we will fight them on the landing grounds, you can see that he practiced the lessons he had learned.
We shall fight in France, we shall fight on the seas and oceans, we shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air, we shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight on the landing grounds, we shall fight in the fields and in the streets, we shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
He uses typical rhetorical techniques like repetition and emphasis, lists, things like this.
This is the lesson. Never give in. Never give in. Never, never, never.
Back upstairs at Chartwell, my guide, Carol Kenwright, led Paul Addison and myself next door from Churchill's study into his inner sanctum, a room not normally seen by visitors to the house.
We've got pictures of his horses.
The leader's bedroom is a snug and warm corner for sleep and work.
Etching of the Battle of Blenheim.
And again, directly off this room is a bathroom. I notice it's one of those bathrooms low down, so you step down into it.
You do,
I
indeed.
I presume, given the size of Mr. Churchill at the time, that was the most convenient way to get into a bath.
I'm sure it was, absolutely. And the secretaries that I have had the privilege of meeting will talk about in going in there to use the bathroom and continuing with his dictation.
So they'd be standing outside?
They would be sitting in the chair or possibly having to follow behind him with their notebooks.
While he's in the bath, sort of blowing bubbles. That's rather a good thought.
When the thoughts were flowing, the thoughts were flowing. That's what's going on.
So what we're looking at is a recording of Churchill's voice that's been captured.
For a closer examination of the nuts and bolts of what makes a Winston Churchill speech such an impressive and individual performance, I've now come to a linguistic analysis laboratory at University College London.
Well, that allows me to compare one reading with the other reading.
Phonetician Dr. Mark Huckvale's computer screen displays two wiggly lines representing sequences of sound, of which the uppermost is part of arguably Churchill's greatest speech, the celebrated Finest Hour addressed to the House of Commons, which he gave on the 18th of June 1940. Below on the screen is a similar trace, but one that differs in some significant ways. It's a reading by myself of that same speech.
I think the most obvious difference to begin with is simply just the speed of it. So for this particular passage, you take about 60 seconds to read it out, and Churchill takes about over 90 seconds to read it out, so he's definitely much slower. But also, he has these very extraordinary dramatic pauses almost between every prosodic phrase, which really slows down the whole thing dramatically.
We're looking at the screen here, and what it reminds me of is a cardiogram. Can we talk about the way that Churchill varied his pitch compared with my own as a professional broadcaster?
Well, I think the range of pitch is quite similar. It's about an octave from the bottom of the range to the top in both your reading and in Churchill's performance. Of course, Churchill does have a lower pitch overall than you. He's about three semitones or lower. His average pitch is lower, and you can hear that quite dramatically in his voice. At times, though, his pitch changes are in rather strange positions. For example, this is your reading of one particular part out of the passage. It's by the lights of perverted science.
By the lights of perverted science.
And that's how you would, I think, how any normal person would read that, perverted science. And whereas Churchill says something very strange, he says,
by the lights of perverted science.
I think you could either say, charitably, this is, he's trying to make it more interesting, or you could say, this is, he just really got lost somewhere in the text. And he got to the end, he thought the end of the sentence was somewhere around perverted, and he got to the bottom of his pitch range and then said, oops, I've got another word to put in there, and then added it to the end. So a little bit strange in places.
And I think the standard 1930s and 1940s upper class voice, and indeed BBC reporters wrote about it, the standard public voice was actually rather high. In fact, the Queen has it.
Professor Jean Seaton again.
High, clear and precise, and a bit sort of a plum in your mouth. And that was the standard tough voice. Churchill hasn't got that voice at all. He's got a lovely, deep, fruity voice, a warm, embracing. I mean, it is a tremendous voice. Is it a sexy voice?
Obviously, the interesting thing is this very last sentence, you know, this was their finest hour part. And almost everywhere along here, you see some very strange differences in pitch. So, for example, where you have...
Lasts for 1,000 years.
Definitely a normal way of putting the emphasis, really, on years. Churchill does it like this.
Lasts for 1,000 years.
And he's definitely trying to say this is 1,000 years. This is the part of the emphasis where he wants to put it. And almost everywhere you look in this, the stress seems to be in the wrong place. So where you have...
Men will still say.
Men will still say. The emphasis on still. Churchill has...
Men will still say.
What? That can't be right.
I think he's rather more impressive.
You think yours is
to get that right. Yeah.
Okay. And I mean, he's trying to make obviously dramatically. And of course, you end at this very last part of this phrase, which is a climax in terms of the Churchill's case. Whereas in your case, you're reading it, you're just sort of happy to get to the end of the paragraph. And so you fall in pitch very naturally.
This was their finest hour.
Whereas Churchill knows this is the climax. This is the bit of the speech that's going to be remembered. And so he articulates it completely differently.
This was their finest hour.
And so, first of all, this very strange, huge raise in pitch on this, which is very unusual.
This!
Right over the top of his pitch range. Well, you'd expect it to be the stress to be on finest, and it's a very weak stress on finest.
But their finest hour.
So, again, you have to say, well, is this kind of part of the skill and the of the performance or the dramatic quality of the performance that is moving these stresses around, or is it more kind of accidental than that, or is it over rehearsed? I think maybe part of this is that once you've read something so many times, you sort of forget what it actually means and start to move stresses around without thinking what the actual words represent, perhaps.
I am glad to have an opportunity at this time of crisis.
Mark Huckvale may have been struck by the unusual intonation patterns that Churchill displayed in one of his most famous speeches, but here's a thing. A rare recording of the 34-year-old Churchill, 9 parliamentary years' experience behind him, and now President of the Board of Trade, etching the Conservative Party's views on budgetary matters on a wax cylinder in 1909.
Not only on tea and sugar, but also upon bread and meat. Not merely, that is to say, on luxury and comfort, but even as an article of prime necessity.
Already, at that relatively early stage of his speech-making career, he was deploying exactly the same vocal tricks as noticed by the phoneticians in speeches 30 years later, and rather too often for comfort. Now compare with Professor John Wells his Battle of Britain speech 30 years later.
Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
There's that intonation. So much owed. Da da da. By so many to so few.
Yes, and it comes over very powerfully, of course, doesn't it?
In his speech about the Battle of Britain, he uses the word about the airmen, you know, few. And of course, where is few? Crucially, it's in the speech before Agincourt from Shakespeare's Henry V, where he talks about the happy few, we happy few who are here at this present, at this battle. So it will just trigger that latent memory.
Would you say that his prose had a poetic dimension?
Oh, there's absolutely no doubt whatsoever that it has a poetic dimension. And it's really fascinating looking at this. It's September 3rd, 1939, a speech to the House of Commons. He begins, "In this solemn hour, it is a consolation to recall and to dwell upon our repeated efforts for peace. All have been ill-starred, but all have been faithful and sincere." And straight away, I was struck by the way he repeats this L sound. All, dwell, recall, consolation, moral, value, L, L, L. And it sounded to me like a bell tolling. And this sense of building up this assonance as a way of creating a sound effect which goes with the sentiment that he's expressing was tremendously powerful.
I think the ones which perhaps linger most in the mind are the ones where, having engaged in a speech with very romantic diction and very long rolling sentences, he would suddenly introduce a quite sudden effect, almost a kind of shock effect, a very colloquial phrase with a very strong punch. For example, where he is talking about the growing support which the United States is giving to Britain. And in a direct appeal to the United States, he says, "Give us the tools and we will finish the job."
Give us the tools and we will finish the job.
And Churchill realized the dramatic value of suddenly changing the temperature or changing the tone or the idiom of his speech. And there was a way in which Churchill was a pioneer of the soundbite.
Because of the big differences between the timing...
Finally, back to Mark Huckvale for one last experiment. Keen to get to the bottom of the Churchillian vocal magic, Mark wondered, was the key quite simply in all those long pauses?
So basically what I did was to take that last sentence of Churchill and try and give it the timing that you gave it. So essentially it eliminates the pauses and speeds everything up. And the question is, does that remove some of the dramatic effect of it? This is what it sounds like.
But if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
And the speed indeed does lose some of the drama quality of it. You dropped all of those pauses, but the whole thing seems much more rushed. And we could do this the other way around, of course, which is quite fun, so that we can take your particular reading and we can slow it down and give it the timing of Churchill. And it actually gives you a quite much more dramatic performance.
If the British Empire and its Commonwealth lasts for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
I sound a bit slurred too, apart from that.
Well, it's strange that when you speak that slowly, you obviously we've taken your rapid speech and slowed it down, so it does seem more slurred as a consequence of slowing it down.
That vocally and emotionally Winston Churchill's finest hour coincided with the moment when the people he led were subjected to the greatest test of resolve and valour known to history wasn't simply a matter of chance. Paul Addison.
Well, we're all very fulsome because of 1940, above all else, I think. But you have to look back before that, of course. Consider, for example, his long campaign over India in the early 1930s, when instead of being contemptuous of Hitler and his grisly gang, he was contemptuous of Mahatma Gandhi. Now that, even at the time, was regarded by most people as a serious error of judgment, and indeed of taste.
Today, these cabinet war rooms and Chartwell are both museums. The discs of Churchill's stirring words are scratchy and old and consigned to the vaults of historic recordings. But here, deep under the streets of London, it's still not so difficult to summon up those moments when the nation was in extreme peril and Churchill's roar brought men and women clustering around their wireless sets.
Suddenly you had someone with fire in his belly, and you could tell by listening to him for a minute or two that here was someone who was a fighter, who was crackling with aggression. And fortunately for the British people, no longer crackling with aggression on behalf of one political party against another, but crackling with aggression against an enemy whom everyone wanted to defeat.
We shall defend our island, and with the British Empire around us, we shall fight on, unconquerable, until the curse of Hitler is lifted from the brows of men. We are sure that in the end, all will be well.
Churchill's Roar was presented by Melvyn Bragg and produced by Simon Elms.
To mark the 40th anniversary of Churchill's death, BBC Radio 4 presents The Fringes of Power.
Friday, May the 24th. Went early to Admiralty House and met the PM, dressed in the most brilliant of flowery dressing gowns and puffing a long cigar. It is refreshing to work with somebody who refuses to be depressed even by the most formidable danger that has ever threatened this country. We looked across the sunlit channel to France and could scarcely bring ourselves to realize it was enemy territory.
This week's Book of the Week, The Fringes of Power, Monday to Friday at 9:45 in the morning.
Whatever Winston's shortcomings, he seems to be the man for the occasion.
And you can also hear Fringes of Power at 12:30. Now for something completely different. Peter France leads the way as we journey along the radio.